Good morning all, good morning students. Welcome to Telangana State Model Schools webinars. Today we have botany session and today we have with us a passionate academician, social activist and a best teacher awardee from Chief Minister Government of Telangana, Dr. A. Venugopal Reddy, Principal Telangana State Model School, Ganmukhala, Veenavanka, Karimnagar District. And being a passionate academician with a great social responsibility, sir has contributed towards in giving awareness towards COVID and reformation in education systems and so on. He wrote several articles on education system and several other articles on education and other general interests. And he had kickstarted botany subject webinars by introducing the overview of first year syllabus and also explained the living world chapter with amazing PowerPoint presentations with images and animations. Students, I think you have better revisited so many times all the chapters sir has introduced. And good morning and welcome, sir.
Good morning, madam.
Now I am privileged to invite Dr. A. Venugopal Reddy Garu to take over the session. Sir, please.
Okay, madam. Thank you very much for your beautiful introduction. Good morning, children. Earlier we had a brief overview of the entire botany. Later I discussed about the living world. After that, Mrs. Bharati from TSMS Jarasangam discussed about the biological classification. Today I am taking you into the third chapter that is called Science of Plants. So we are in the BIPC stream. As part of the BIPC stream, we are studying botany, zoology, physics, and chemistry. Zoology is the study of animals or science of animals, whereas botany is science of plants. So in this particular chapter, we are going to discuss how this botany originated, evolved, and why we are studying this botany. And what are the different branches of botany? This is the main aim of this particular chapter. So as you know, the study of living organisms is called biology. Bios means life. Logos means discourse. Discourse means explanation. So that is a Greek term. The study of living organisms is called biology. Actually, this chapter is very important from the point of NEET, MCET and other competitive examinations. So, bios means life and logos means discourse. The study of the living organisms. Living organisms includes both plants, animals and microorganisms. So, from when this biology was started? Actually, biology started since the evolution of the human beings. When man was born, he started observing all the living organisms present in and around him. He observed that there are two types of things. One, non-living material like stone, sky, earth, etc. But he also observed that some of them are having life like him. So he was able to grasp the difference between the living things and non-living things. And he able to understand the utility of different living things. So the foundation of biology is not done about 100 years back or 1000 years back. It was done before several thousands of years. That is before Christ in the ancient times. So this is a very old subject. What is biology? Biology is the story of evolution of living organisms on Earth. Living organisms, as we said in the earlier classes, they evolved. Evolved means when we read certain scriptures, when we read some mythological stories, it appears as if all the living organisms developed at a time. Microorganism and man developed at a time. Plants and animals developed at a time. But that is not the case as far as the science is concerned. In the science, as per the science, organisms evolved gradually, one after the another. Unicellular organisms gave rise to multicellular organisms. In the multicellular organisms also, they evolved one after another. Bacteria, algae, fungi, gymnosperms, angiosperms, before them bryophytes, pteridophytes, like this. It is a slow and continuous process. The evolution has taken thousands of years, not 1 or 2 years. We cannot see evolution because we survive only a fraction. For example, if a movie is there, that movie runs for 2.5 hours. If you watch the movie for 1 or 2 seconds, you cannot tell the whole story. How it originated, you know, never know. How it will end in the climax, you never know. We are like that. We may survive for 60 years, but that is only even a microsecond of the total evolution on the earth. But biology is fast developing like many other sciences. In the last 10 years, we had cell phones. Later we had 2G, 3G, 4G. Next year we are getting 5G. It appears that particular branch of science and technology is developing at a faster rate. True. Yeah, about 100 years back, we used to see only planets, but now man is landing on the planets. That means space technology developed a lot. Chemical technology developed a lot. Geotechnology developed a lot. But what about biology? Biology also developing at a faster rate. The simple example is vaccine for COVID-19. Earlier, it used to take 10 to 12 years to develop a successful vaccine. 10 to 12 years to develop a vaccine. Now, within 9 months or 10 months, we had 8 vaccines for COVID-19. Earlier, one vaccine, 10 to 12 years. Now, we had 8 to 9 vaccines within 9 months. Within next 3 months, we will be having more than 40 vaccines. How it is possible? Because of the development in the field of biology, plant tissue culture, genetic engineering, stem cell technology, DNA fingerprinting, whatnot. Multiple latest technologies are developing in the field of sciences also. The biggest development has taken place only in the last 30 years. In fact, we are now in the golden era of biology. Microbiology, biochemistry, biotechnology, genetic engineering, bioinformatics, nanobiotechnology. Earlier, it was study of only and botany and zoology, study of plants and animals, but not now. We developed a plethora of techniques. At the center of all these techniques is human being only. I will say one simple example. Genetic engineering is the most advanced branch of the biology. So welcome back. We had a So welcome back. Unfortunately, we had some power interruption. Sometimes it is helpless. We cannot do anything. So let us go back. So we are in the golden era of the biology. Golden era of the biology means we are living in the world where technology, biological technology is happening at a faster rate. In the recent past, we are having several techniques such as chromatography, centrifugation, electrophoresis, spectroscopy, and other modern techniques, which are very useful and made the life of scientists very easy to develop new things. As you go upper in your studies, say you go to the degree BSc, later you go to the MSc, then after that, if you go for the PhD, you will follow all these techniques. So how this botany originated? Origin means how it started. Earlier, it was used to be called as a plant science. Plant science means biology in relation to plants is called plant science. Animal science, physical science, chemical science, political science. Science means knowledge. The knowledge of plants, hence it is called as plant science. But later, it was used to be called as Boskin, B-O-U-S-K-E-I-N, Boskin. Why it called like that? In Greek language, bos means cattle. Cattle generally eats plants. So it is a cattle feed. Boskin means cattle feed. Plants are a feed for the cattle. So they used to call it as Boskin. Study of plant sciences earlier known as Boskin. Gradually, it became botane, and finally, we are calling it as botany. So first, it was called as plant science. Later, it was known as Boskin because plants are the feed for the cattle. Later, it is called as botane. Now, we are calling it as botany. Simply, this is the origin. So why man used to observe the plants? Because plants are having lot of significance in the human being's life. Unless we have some interest on anything, we won't observe. For example, we don't observe the things which are not interested to us. We are interested on food. Food is provided by the plants. We want some shelter that is also earlier provided by the plants only thatches. Earlier we are not having these concrete buildings, etc. We want some cloths to cover ourselves, comes from the cotton plant. We want medicines, earlier all medicines were Ayurvedic only. So since time immemorial, not now, since time immemorial, human beings are having certain interest on the plants. That interest is because of the food needs, shelter needs, cloths, and medicines. That is why, since time immemorial, man used to have interest on the plants. When they shown interest, they used to record them. They used to record all their observations. Egyptians and Assyrians about 4000 BC years, that means around 6000 years back, recorded all the information in the form of pictures. They are called hieroglyphics. Hieroglyphics. This is an important essay question. No, sorry, neat question. They used to record. Next, in the next page, I will show. In our country also, all the Vedas, all the four Vedas, contain information regarding the medicinal plants. So that means 4000 BC, about 6000 years back also, man had interest on the plants. 2000 BC, Vedas also contain information regarding the plants. That means man had interest on the plants since time immemorial. These are what we told just now back. Hieroglyphics. These are the hieroglyphics. All the plants, animals are drawn in the form of some images. These are our four Vedas. Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sama Veda, Atharvana Veda. All the four Vedas also contain information regarding the medicinal plants. Out of that, Atharvana Veda contains information regarding the 293 medicinal plants. Lot of information. So, since time immemorial, we are having interest in the plants. In 1300 BC, about 3300 years back, B.C. Parasara written a book, Krishi Prasaram. In that book, he written about all the agricultural practices. All the agricultural practices. He also wrote another book, Vrikshayurveda. In this, he discussed about the medicinal plants. 1300 years BC. That means around 3,300 years back, one of our ancient scientists, plant scientist, written a book, two books, not one, Krishi Prasaram and Vrikshayurveda. One is dealing about the agriculture, and another one is dealing about the medicinal plants. So botany history is very old. Botany history is very old. Then from the ancient times, if you move into the before Christ period, Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle. They were in all the subjects. Unlike we, I am a botanist. I don't know about zoology. One of the zoology teacher, he never knows about the botany. Physics teacher never knows about the chemistry. Chemistry teacher never knows about the physics. But that is not the case with these three people. They are everywhere. They are in every part of the science, whether it is political science, physical science, biological science, whatever it is. Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle. Socrates from 470 to 399 BC. Plato from 428 to 348 BC. Aristotle 384 to 322 BC. They contributed enormously to the field of botany. Then Theophrastus. Theophrastus. 340 BC. That means 2300 years back. He is regarded as a father of botany. Father of botany. He described the characters of about 500 plants in his book. 500 plants in his book. What is the name of that book? De Historia Plantarum. De Historia Plantarum. That means the history of plants. He is Theophrastus and it is his book, De Historia Plantarum. Imagine 2300 years back, writing about 500 plants, their characters, their significance. In 16th and 17th century, we are moving gradually towards the 20th century. Some of the authors developed a book about the medicinal plants, and that book is called Herbals. herbals. Herbals means a book name that discusses about the medicinal plants. In 1623, Gaspard Bahini described about 6,000 plants. 6,000 plants. How many plants you and me know? Hardly 100 plants. But Gaspard Bahin in 1623, that means about 400 years back, described about 6,000 plants. He introduced the concept of binomial nomenclature. Binomial nomenclature. What is binomial nomenclature? Each plant is having two names. Ajadirachta indica, Allium sepa, Mangifera indica, Hibiscus rosa sinensis. Like this, each plant scientific name will have two names. That two names, one is genus name, the second one is species name. That is called binomial nomenclature. That concept was first time proposed by Gaspard Bahin in 1623. Robert Hooke, the father of cell biology, the father of cytology, in 1665, once again about 400 years back, say 600 years back, he published a book called Micrographia. Here you can see Robert Hooke, his microscope, his observation, cork cells. He was the first scientist to describe the structure of the cell. That is why he's called father of cell biology. Then we have our own Anton van Leeuwenhoek, father of microbiology. Father of microbiology. In 1675, that means around 500 years back, 545 years back, first time he identified the microorganisms and he called them as animalcules. He has given the drawings of them. He has studied the structure of the sperm cell, white blood cells, red blood cells, bacterial cells. So 500 years back is Anton van Leeuwenhoek. This is his compound microscope. He was known as father of microbiology. Then we have Nehemiah Grew, Marcello Malfici. These two persons, first two persons, left and middle, who studied about the internal structure of the plants, xylem, phloem, anatomy, parenchyma, collenchyma, chlorenchyma. Then we have Camarius in 1694, discovered the sexual reproduction in plants. Sexual reproduction. Plants reproduces by two mechanisms, asexual and sexual. So he discovered the sexual reproduction in the plants. Then as we progress into the 18th century, in the 18th century, the emphasis was on taxonomy and physiology. Taxonomy and physiology. What is a taxonomy? Naming of the plants, classification, arrangement in a systematic manner. This is called taxonomy. What is physiology? The study of various activities that are taking place inside the plant body, photosynthesis, respiration, excretion. This is called physiology. Absorption of water, all these are called physiology. So in the 18th century, the emphasis was on taxonomy and physiology. Carolus von Linnaeus, he popularized the binomial nomenclature. Earlier we have seen Gaspard Bahin, who described 6,000 plants and he introduced the concept of binomial nomenclature. But that concept is popularized by Carolus von Linnaeus in 18th century. He also proposed the sexual system of classification. That means basically classification done basing on the flower floral structures. That is called sexual system of classification. So he is Carolus von Linnaeus. He is a Swedish scientist. He developed binomial nomenclature in 200 years back. Every organism will have two word Latin name. It will have two word Latin name. by two nominal name for all the living organisms, not only for the plants, for microorganisms. For example, Mycobacterium tuberculosis. Mycobacterium tuberculosis. It is a two-word name. Streptococci is the genus name, for example, if you take. Staphylococcus aureus. Staphylococcus is the genus name. Aureus is the species name. Mycobacterium leprae. Mycobacterium is the genus name. Leprae is the species name. For animals also, the same system. Homo sapiens. Homo genus. Sapiens. Species. For plants also, the same system. So, binomial nomenclature. Binomial nomenclature means two-worded name. That is called binomial nomenclature. So, that was developed about 200 years ago by Carlos von Linnaeus. In the 18th century, Stephen Hales studied about the absorption of and the conduction of water through xylem by root pressure. Plant systems will have two vessels, xylem and phloem. Dear students, please understand. The plant system will have two transport system, two conduction system. One is called xylem and another one is called phloem. Xylem helps in movement of water from roots to the stem, leaves, fruits, flowers. Phloem helps in the conduction of food material from leaves to the all other body parts. Stephen Hales was the first scientist to observe the conduction of water through xylem by using the root pressure. Another scientist, Joseph Priestley, he discovered that plants absorb carbon dioxide and liberate oxygen. But he called the carbon dioxide as a toxic gas and the oxygen as the pure gas. So he was the pioneer of the photosynthesis actually. If you go into the 19th century, we are coming slowly towards the current history. In the 19th century, lot of progress taken place in the field of botany. And botany is diversified into different branches. Till then, it was existing as only a single branch, but it was diversified into different branches, genetics, plant physiology, taxonomy, anatomy. We will discuss about the branches of botany in the next session. All these branches are formed in the 19th century. Gregor John Mendel of Czechoslovakia. He is known as the father of genetics. Father of genetics. Why he is known as father of genetics? He introduced the concept of laws of inheritance. What is laws of inheritance? All our characters are inherited from our parents. That is called laws of inheritance. In the second year, we are having a separate chapter to discuss about this. He conducted monohybrid cross, dihybrid cross experiments, and he proposed laws of inheritance that are still valid even after 350 years. That is why he is known as the father of genetics, Gregor John Mendel. Actually, he is a Christian father. So he conducted monohybrid cross with the dihybrid cross with the pea plants. Here we are having monohybrid cross. In the monohybrid cross, he crossed green peas with the yellow peas. And finally, he was having four different groups. So that we will study in detail when we go to the second year and when we study the genetics. We continue with the 19th century. Haeckel was the first to initiate ecological studies. Ecology, study of our surroundings. Ecology means study of our surroundings. Every living organism, not only plant, every living organism has to depend on its surroundings for its survival. Each living organism is influenced by its surroundings and it influences its surroundings. Organism gets influenced and influences it. Both the physical, chemical, and biological factors of our surroundings are called ecology. Haeckel was the first scientist to study about the plant ecology. Later, different scientists, taxonomists means who study about the classification of the living organisms. Dickendall, Endlich, Bentham, and Hooker, they proposed different types of classifications. Now we are following five kingdom classification mostly. And Charles Darwin put forward the theory of evolution. Evolution means a formation of one organism from the another organism. New organism, formation of a new organism from the existing organism is called evolution. If you go to the kingdom Plantae, or if you go to the autotrophic group of organisms, there you will find some evolution. In the animal kingdom, Pisces, reptiles, avians, and mammals, evolution. In the plant system also, you can see such evolution, bryophyta, pteridophyta, gymnosperms, angiosperms. Before them, algae, thallophytes. Thallophyta, bryophyta, pteridophyta, gymnosperms, angiosperms. All these are multicellular. Before them, unicellular. In the animal kingdom also, you can see protozoa, porifera, coelenterata, platyhelminthes, nematihelminthes, annelida, arthropoda, like that. So evolution is a continuous process. How this evolution occurred and why it occurred, that was discussed by Charles Darwin in the theory of evolution. And Buchner was the first scientist to discover enzyme, gymase, in the yeast cells. Yeast is a unicellular fungi. In that unicellular fungi, he discovered the enzyme gymase. So biochemistry of the living organisms also started with that. It started as a single branch, single stem, but botany is diversifying into different branches. Joseph Hooker and George Bentham, they have written a book called Genera Plantarum in 18th century. That is known as Bentham and Hooker classification. The right side person is Charles Darwin, who proposed the theory of evolution. Then we have Hugo de Vries, 1901, 20th century. He proposed the concept of mutations, sudden heritable changes in the living organisms. Loss of inheritance was proposed by Gregor John Mendel. That means all the parents will transfer their character to the offspring. All the offspring will receive their characters from their parents. That is called loss of inheritance. But sometimes sudden changes will occur. That sudden changes are known as mutations. The concept of mutations was proposed by Hugo de Vries in 1901. And in 1902, Sutton and Boveri, they discovered the role of chromosomes in heredity. We are having 23 pairs of chromosomes. Our parents are also having 23 pairs of chromosomes. We are receiving some of the characters from father, some of the characters from mother. That's why we are not exact copies of our parents. We are a bit different because of this pairs of chromosomes. But Satyan and Bhavari, they proposed that because of the chromosomes only we are getting these characters. Then chromosomes contains DNA. That DNA contains some structure. Double helical structure of DNA was discovered by Watson and Crick in 1953, about 70 years back. 1953. We started this chapter in the ancient times. That means a time immemorial. From there, we moved into the 6,000 years back. From 6,000 years back, now we are in the timeline of 70 years back. And RNA as genetical material was discovered by Frankel Contract in 1956. Watson and Crick discovered the double helical structure of DNA by in 1953. In 1956, Frankel Conrad discovered the genetic nature of the RNA in 1956. Our own man, Hargobind Khurana, the Nobel Prize winner, Watson and Crick was also Nobel Prize winners. Hargobind Khurana synthesized artificial gene in the laboratory. So he got the Nobel Prize, Hargobind Khurana. The most important development in the field of botany is plant tissue culture. What is plant tissue culture? You take a small mass of plant, whether from stem or root or from leaf, from anywhere. This is isolated plant tissue. You wash it, sterilize it, and put this plant tissue in a media that is called tissue culture media, and you incubate that media containing flask in an incubator for about a few days, for say 20 days. After 20 days, you will have a small plant. Normally, plants develop from the seed. To develop a plant, you have to put a seed in the soil. That seed will give rise to a plant. But that problem with that technique is the seed contains characters of two parents, mother and father plants. As it contains two characters, it may not contain desired, it may not contain desired characters. In this technology, what we are doing is we are taking a small tissue of root, stem, or leaf, putting it in a media. In that media, it develops into a plant. The plant will be 100% identical to that of the parent. That is called plant tissue culture. By using this technology, we can develop lakhs of identical plants within few days. We will study about this plant tissue culture also in the second year. That experiments were carried out by Hanning, Shimakura, Skoog, White, Nish, and our own scientist Maheshwari. Since ancient times, our own scientists, Indian scientists, contributed a lot to the field of botany. And electron microscope. You might have seen a simple microscope with single lens. You might have seen a compound microscope with two lenses, but you never seen an electron microscope. Electron microscope is present only in the bigger laboratories like CCMB, Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology, IICT, etc. By using electron microscope, we can see any living organism which are not normally visible to the eye. Here we are showing the structure of the coronavirus. The total coronavirus present on this earth can be put it in a single tablespoon. Just imagine all the viruses, all the coronaviruses which we are having at present in the world can be put it in a teaspoon. We cannot see it. But by using an electron microscope, you can view it. That was developed by Knoll and Rusk. Electron microscope is of two types: scanning electron microscope and transmission electron microscope. So that is also possible in 20th century. Auxins. Auxins are plant growth regulators. Plant growth regulators. Auxins, gibberellins, cytokinins, abscisic acid, ethylene. These five are called as plant growth regulators. We are having in the second year. Out of them, auxin was the first plant growth regulator to be discovered by F.W. Wendt in 1928. Citric acid cycle, tricarboxylic acid cycle, was discovered by Hans Krebs. It is also known as Krebs cycle. It played an important role in the plant physiology. This also happened in 20th century only. Then enzyme crystallization was done by Sumner in, then Robert Hill, Rubin, Arnon, Emerson and others. They studied about the light reaction of photosynthesis. These are all physiological activities. If we go back, this Krebs cycle of respiration, auxins, these are all plant physiological activities. In the 20th century, focused on the plant physiology. This is part of the photosynthesis. Robert Hill, Rubin, Arnon, Emerson, and others, they studied about the light reaction. Photosynthesis also contains dark reaction. C3 pathway. In the plant photosynthesis, two types of pathways takes place, C3 pathway and C4 pathway. C3 pathway was discovered by Melvin Calvin, Benson, and Basham. This is C3 pathway that we will study in the second year. C4 pathway, which is also known as the Hatch-Slack pathway, that was discovered in 1976 by Hatch and Slack. One Indian scientist, V.S. Ramadas, also played an important role in C4 photosynthesis discovery. The field of botany is still growing. Palynology. Palynology means study of pollen grains. Pollen grains are very microscopic, but this microscopic pollen grains play a very important role in the hybridization experiments, plant breeding experiments. Wodehouse, P.K.K. Nair, C.G.K. Ramanujam, they worked on that. Bessie, Rendell, Hutchinson, Tegjohn, Cronquist, they were working on the modern taxonomy. This is just like reading about our family history. We are here because of our forefathers. The branch of the field of botany, just you once again go to the starting. Golden, we are in the golden era of biology. Botany. That golden era is possible because of the studies that were taken place in the ancient times. Man was only interested in food, shelter, and medicines initially. Egyptians, Assyrians, they drawn the information regarding the plants in the form of some graphics. Our own Vedas contains a lot of information regarding the medicinal plants. Several Indian scientists of about 3000 years back, they've written some books like Rishi Prasaram and Vriksha Ayurveda. Several Greek philosophers like Socrates, Plato, Aristotle also contributed to the botany. Theophrastus is known as the father of botany because he studied and described about 500 plants. He written a book called De Historia Plantarum. Gaspard Bahin introduced the concept of binomial nomenclature. That means each plant or each living organism contains a two-worded name. He studied about the 6,000 plants about 500 years back. Robert Hooke is known as the father of cell biology. He was the first person to discover the cell. He written a book called Micrographia. Anton van Leeuwenhoek is known as the father of microbiology. He first time identified the microorganisms. He called them animalcules, but actually he was the discoverer of bacteria. And some of the scientists, they studied about the internal structure of the plants and their sexual reproduction. Linnaeus was the scientist to popularize the binomial nomenclature system and the sexual system of classification. Then in the 18th century, certain physiological experiments are done to identify what is happening inside the plant body. Gregor John Mendel is known as father of genetics because he introduced the concept of loss of inheritance. That means all the characters of us are inherited from our parents. He conducted monohybrid cross, dihybrid cross, and other types of experiments. Ecological studies were initiated in the 19th century. Ecology means study of our surroundings. Charles Darwin introduced the concept of theory of evolution. As per the environmental requirements, the living organism constantly modifies their structure and function. That is called theory of evolution. The branch of biochemistry also started in 19th century only. Then Hugo de Vries introduced the concept of mutation, sudden heritable changes in the structure of the plant. At this time, the components responsible for inheritance, mutations were the focus of study. Sutton and Bavary discovered the role of chromosomes in hereditary. Watson and Crick identified the structure of double-stranded DNA. RNA as a genetic material was identified by Frankel Conrat. Our own H.G. Corona synthesized the artificial gene in the 20th century. Plant tissue culture, development of a full-fledged plant from a single mass of tissue is called plant tissue culture. A group of scientists worked on that. And electron microscope, which revolutionized the study of the cell biology, microbiology, biochemistry, was developed by Noll and Ruska in this century. Then we have plant growth regulators discovery, plant physiological activities, Krebs cycle discovery by Hans Krebs, and the studies on photosynthesis by a group of scientists, and the C3 pathway by a group of scientists, C4 pathway by some other group. And so different areas of botany were explored by different people across the world, and that exploration is being continued. So we can learn so many topics from this, explain how the term botany has emerged, who is popularly known as father of botany, why Mendel is considered as father of genetics, who discovered the cell, what are the contributions of Watson and Crick. So it is like a history of botany. By studying, by going through this chapter, we can get an insight into the development of a branch of botany. In the future sessions, we will discuss about the why we study about the botany, and we will study about the different branches of botany. So these are the assignments for you. Very, very important chapter as far as the MCET, NEET, and other competitive exams are concerned. Thank you. I thank the additional director and joint director and the host of today's program, Srimati BDRS Manjari, for giving me the platform and the time to share this session. Thank you. Manjari madam.
Thank you, sir. You had beautifully explained the importance of plants in every aspect of our lives. Yes, plants feed us, clothe us, respire oxygen, provide us medicines and more. So thank you so much for the wonderful explanation of wonderful and very clear explanation of introduction, importance, discoveries and development of plant science, which is essential in maintaining the world around us. Thank you, sir. We will continue the science of plant, very interesting session in the next session. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Okay, madam. Thank you. Thank you very much. Hello. Srikanth garu, good morning.
Shubhodaya mitrama.
Srikanth sir, good morning sir.
Good morning, good morning. Ramanarao, good morning.
Sir, good morning, sir. Venugopal, sir, good morning, sir.
Good morning, good morning.
Sir, how are you, sir?
Fine, fine.
Sir, ఇంకా లైవ్ క్లోజ్ అవ్వలేదు.
అవలేదా? ఓకే.